Hello everyone, welcome to ANAT AV. This video provides a detailed description of the morphological appearance and the structural composition of the skull base. The skull base consists of three cranial fossae, as anterior, middle and posterior fossae. First, let's have a look at the anterior cranial fossa. The anterior cranial fossa is formed by the orbital part of the frontal bone, the cribriform plate of the ethmoid, the lesser wings, and the anterior part of the body of the sphenoid. And this is bounded anteriorly by the frontal bone. Posteriorly, it is separated from the middle cranial fossa by the lesser wing of the sphenoid and the anterior margin of the sulcus chiasmaticus. The sphenoparietal sinus runs on the edge of the posterior border. This also fits into the stem of the lateral cerebral sulcus. Inferiorly, the posterior border forms the upper boundary of the superior orbital fissure. Medially, it is connected to the body of the sphenoid by anterior and posterior roots, which enclose the optic canal. The cribriform plate of the ethmoid bone separates the anterior cranial fossa from the nasal cavity. The orbital plate of the frontal bone separates the orbit from the fossa.
Now, let's move on to middle cranial fossa. The middle cranial fossa consists of a median part formed by the sphenoid body and right and left lateral parts formed by the cerebral surfaces of the greater wings of the sphenoid and the squamous and petrous parts of the temporal bone. It is deeper than the anterior cranial fossa and is shaped like a butterfly. Anteriorly, it is bounded by the posterior border of the lesser wings of the sphenoid, anterior clinoid process, anterior margin of the sulcus chiasmaticus. Posteriorly, it is bounded by the superior border of the petrous temporal bone, the dorsum cellae of the sphenoid, and laterally limited by the greater wing of the sphenoid, antero-inferior angle of the parietal bone, squamous temporal bone. The pituitary gland lies in its fossa, the cella tersica, with the diaphragma cellae above it, the tuberculum cellae in front of it, and the dorsum cellae behind. A pituitary tumor arising upwards presses on the optic chiasma, which lies above the sulcus chiasmaticus, causing loss of vision of the temporal fields, which is known as bitemporal hemianopia. The lateral area is deep and lodges the temporal lobe of the brain. It is related anterior to the orbit, laterally to the temporal fossa, and inferiorly to the infratemporal fossa. The superior orbital fissure opens anteriorly into the orbit. The greater wing of sphenoid presents the foramen rotundum leading anteriorly to the pterygopalatine fossa. The foramen ovale lies posterolateral to the foramen rotundum. It leads inferiorly to the infratemporal fossa. The foramen spinosum lies posterolateral to the foramen ovale, which also leads inferiorly to the infratemporal fossa. The foramen lacerum lies posteromedial to the foramen ovale. Further posteriorly, the anterior surface of the petrous temporal bone presents a trigeminal impression lying near the apex behind the foramen lacerum. It lodges the trigeminal ganglion within its dural cave. The hiatus and groove for the greater pretrosal nerve are present laterally to the trigeminal impression. They lead to the foramen lacerum. Lateral to that is the hiatus and groove for the lesser pretrosal nerve. Still more laterally, there is the arcuate eminence produced by the superior semicircular canal.
Finally, let's have a look at the posterior cranial fossa. This is the largest and the deepest of the three cranial fossae. This is bounded anteriorly by the superior border of the petrous temporal bone and the dorsum cilia of the sphenoid bone. Posteriorly, it is bounded by the squamous part of the occipital bone. And on each side, it is bounded by the mastoid part of the temporal bone and the mastoid angle of the parietal bone. It lodges the convexities of the cerebellar hemispheres as well as the pons and the medulla oblongata. The foramen magnum lies in the floor of the fossa. The anterior part of the foramen is overlapped by the occipital condyles. The clavus is the sloping surface in front of the foramen magnum. It is formed by the fusion of the posterior part of the body of the sphenoid and the base occiput. On each side, the clavus is separated from the petrous temporal bone by the petro-occipital fissure, which is grooved by the inferior petrosal sinus. The jugular foramen lies at the posterior end of the petro-occipital fissure. Condylar part of the occipital bone shows the hypoglossal canal, piercing the bone postero-anterior to the jugular tubercle. The posterior surface of the petrous part of the temporal bone forms the anterolateral wall of the posterior cranial fossa. The internal acoustic meatus opens above the anterior part of the jugular foramen. The squamous part of the occipital bone shows the internal occipital protuberance, which lies opposite the external occipital protuberance. It is also related to the confluence of the sinuses. The internal occipital crest runs in the median plane from the internal occipital protuberance to the foramen magnum. The transverse sulcus is quite wide and runs laterally from the internal occipital protuberance to the mastoid angle of the parietal bone, where it becomes continuous with the sigmoid sulcus. The transverse sulcus lodges the transverse sinus. That brings us to the end of this video on the anatomy of the skull base. If you enjoyed this video and found it helpful, don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. Please share this with your friends and anyone interested in studying anatomy. Thank you for watching ANAT AV.